Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing the ventricular system, as well as the cerebrospinal fluid, or CSF, developed within the ventricular system. And we've discussed the cerebrospinal fluid before when we were discussing the subarachnoid space associated with the spinal cord. But now we get to explore where it actually develops and how it will flow in order to reach that subarachnoid space. And this is through that ventricular system. So I always think the ventricles are hard for students to conceptualize because they often try to make them solid structures, and I think for good reason because they're looking at models like this one. But this model is actually showing the general shape of the space, and that is the key word here, is the ventricular system consists of spaces and connecting channels that are lined with ependymal cell or those supporting cells. So these ventricles and connecting channels are going to be derived from the central lumen of the embryonic neural tube. And the key is these are spaces. And it is in the walls of the ventricles that cerebrospinal fluid, hard to say, is produced. And you can kind of see this represented here in this image in pink. These are representing the choroid plexuses that are on the walls of the ventricles. And that is where cerebrospinal fluid will be produced and it will make its way to the subarachnoid space in a set direction. And that's where all these arrows kind of come into play. We'll get into that a bit. So let's talk a little more about these ventricles. There are four ventricles that are all connected, or they're going to be connected in a set direction. And we will start with the most superiorly located, which are the paired lateral ventricles. So these could be called the first and second ventricles, but they never really are. You'll almost always hear lateral ventricles. And these are going to be located, or these are spaces within the cerebral hemispheres. And it's going to have this very distinct C shape with some horns associated with it. So I'm outlining this. So you're going to have the body, which is the main portion. Then you'll also have an anterior, a posterior, and an inferior horn of the lateral ventricle. So in each lateral ventricle. Both lateral ventricles will drain CSF via the interventricular foramina. So there'll be one for each lateral ventricle, which this is very often hard to distinguish, but it's going to be this connection between the lateral ventricle and the third ventricle. The third ventricle is going to be located in the midline of the diencephalon, so a space in portions of the thalamus and the hypothalamus. It's going to be this kind of oddly shaped region right here. And the third ventricle will be connected to the fourth ventricle by the cerebral aqueduct, which generally is a little bit longer, certainly in comparison to the interventricular foramina. It will run through the midbrain region and will connect to the fourth ventricle. It is the fourth ventricle that is going to be located between the brainstem, specifically the pons and the medulla, and the cerebellum. So it's this general area right here. And the fourth ventricle can also be considered the last ventricle or the more distal ventricle. And from here, the majority of CSF moves into the subarachnoid space. So that subarachnoid space is key here. It will do so via small holes or openings or apertures in that ventricular wall. Although a small amount will also continue into the central canal of the spinal cord. So within the actual spinal cord, the central canal is a vestigial remnant of the ventricular system of the spinal cord. And it kind of just peters out the more distal you get on the spinal cord. But as the majority of CSF moves into the subarachnoid space from the ventricular system, let's focus a bit more on those. There are three main apertures that allow CSF to move from the ventricular system to the subarachnoid space. This will include the single or unpaired median aperture. And you can see that kind of in this general region right here. And then you will also have the paired lateral apertures, so 2 and 3, to get to the 3 apertures. So you can only see one on this hemi section here. There would be a matching one on the other side. And all three of these apertures are going to lead into what are referred to as subarachnoid cisterns, which really are just more expansive or larger subarachnoid spaces. So that pia mater is always going to be really closely adhered to the brain. So that will always be the case. But in certain regions, the arachnoid mater is more tented over and more widely separated from the pia mater, making a naturally occurring larger subarachnoid space referred to as a subarachnoid cistern. And you'll have them kind of throughout the areas surrounding the brain. So that's just a few right there. For our purposes, you don't have to know the specific names of the subarachnoid cisterns. You may in other parts of the curriculum. Again, these subarachnoid cisterns are subarachnoid space. They are continuous with the more generalized subarachnoid space that surrounds the entirety of the central nervous system, including around the spinal cord. Now, don't forget that while I think we likely have it down at this point that CSF is flowing within the subarachnoid space, neurovasculature is also located in this area. So the blood supply for the brain, as well as cranial nerves, will be within this region. Now let's talk a little more about how CSF is formed. These are going to be formed by what's referred to as choroid plexuses. So anytime you're looking at any of these images, it's often shown as kind of a reddish color. These are found in the walls of all the ventricles. And they are going to kind of show up as these pinkish or reddish structures because they're very highly vascularized. And it is from the choroid plexuses that the CSF is secreted. The flow of CSF is proximal to distal or superior to inferior to make its way to the subarachnoid space. And it is continually being produced and being replaced, meaning that older CSF needs to be removed from the subarachnoid space. And it will do so by being reabsorbed into the venous system. And this is possible by what's referred to as arachnoid granulations. So you see kind of right here a few illustrations of what that is. And basically, these arachnoid granulations, or villi, when you're talking about younger individuals, these are extensions of subarachnoid and subarachnoid space that project into the dural venous sinus and allow for the CSF to drain into or be reabsorbed into the venous sinuses. Arachnoid granulations are associated with quite a few dural venous sinuses, but are most frequent and most easily observable associated with the superior sagittal sinus, that sinus that's running along the superior portion of the falx cerebri. Now, in certain pathological conditions, there can be an abnormal accumulation of CSF within the ventricular system, leading to enlargement of portions of the ventricular system. So blockages or obstructions that can occur are most commonly associated with those narrow channels or foramina, so between the different ventricles or to allow movement into the subarachnoid space. And a blockage would most greatly affect the size of the ventricles or the ventricular spaces more proximally. So, say there's a blockage in the intervertebral foramina, kind of in this region here, that would most greatly affect the lateral ventricles and less so in terms of the more distal ventricles. If you had a blockage of the cerebral aqueduct, that would most greatly affect both the lateral ventricles and the third ventricle because those are going to be more proximally associated. And if you had a blockage in any of the apertures or those foramina associated with the fourth ventricle that could affect the whole ventricular system. Hydrocephalus doesn't have to be caused by a blockage of one of those channels. It could be associated with ineffective absorption of CSF. Excellent. We have made it to the summary slide. Please use this slide as a study guide and means of consolidating your knowledge on this topic. As always, please feel free to reach out with any questions to me or any of my anatomy colleagues, and I thank you for your time and attention.